to stand up for your rights. Jump,
get up, stand up,
jump, jump,
stand up for your rights.
Because, you know, it's kind of... Good evening. So, what could you say about Michael Sorkin? What can you say about Michael Sorkin? What can you say? Whatever you say. Sorkin, good friend, personal and the school. Okay. Facts. Thanks. It's like in my line of sight here. Michael Sorkin is the principal of the Michael Sorkin Studio in New York City. It's a. I'm gonna read the facts, which will outline the diverse type of practice that Michael has currently, which is an accumulation of things that he's been involved in over the years that have come to sort of current fruition with the practice that he has. It's a unique practice that I think it's a significant model for many of you out there that are of young enough to be wondering how you're going to practice architecture. This is an example of an invented life. Michael Sorkin is the principal of the Michael Sorkin Studio in New York City, a design practice devoted to both practical and theoretical projects at all scales with a special interest in the city. Current work includes public housing in Vienna, a sustainable urban design scheme for San Francisco, a study of the Lower West Side of Manhattan, a public art installation in Hamburg, a study of Governor's Island in New York Harbor, a village planning study near Vienna, and a condominium development in Miami, Florida. Among recent research projects are Weed, Arizona, a new town plan undertaken as part of a larger study of the conversion of American military bases to cities. Eurasia, a prototypical plan for sustainable urban development in Southeast Asia, a study of a green redevelopment strategy for East New York, Brooklyn, and Shrooms, an experimental loft housing typology. Besides this, Michael is also a professor of urbanism and the director of the Institute of Urbanism at the Academy of Fine Arts in Vienna, and the Gensler Family Distinguished Visiting Critic at Cornell currently. Previously, he's taught at a lot of schools, including SCI-Arc, where he'll teach again soon, I hope. Besides teaching and practicing in the way that he is now, he's written quite a bit. His most recent books include Variations on a Theme Park, which is an anthology of the modern American city, The Exquisite Corpse, a collection of his writings on architecture from the Village Voice, and a new book, The Local Code, which is a description of an imaginary city in the form of a building code. He's practiced architecture since the 70s, initially working through the medium of writing, specifically architectural journalism, and as a teacher. At the end of the 80s, he replaced journalism with a full-time teaching design practice. I'm sure still writing, but primarily teaching and designing. In any form and format, he's a fearless storyteller, focused on what's happening in the moment, spinning out into sets of higher principles, coming out of bigger issues. He speaks to truth without hesitation. He's been, I believe, and this is a very strong belief for our generation, an intelligent voice with conscience and heart. In addition to that, he's also a very funny guy. Please welcome Michael Sorkin.
I know it's Valentine's Day, but this lighting is ridiculous. No necking. Is it necessary that we be absorbed by the dark? Yeah? Hard to fix people in the eye if you can't see any eyes. Christ. Yeah, good evening. Sorry, there was some confusion last semester when I was supposed to come here. The fault is not with me. And in compensation, I'm going to speak twice as long tonight. So relax. I'd like to say a few words about the city and show some work. To begin, let's take a little bit of a walk. How about a slide? Or am I in charge of that? God. Just talking to Michael beforehand about how I've recently been introduced to the culture of eyeglasses for the first time. And I already have this kind of nerdy broken pair. Stupid. From my apartment to my studio is about half an hour walk. 50 minutes or so if I stop for a cappuccino in the New York Times. The trip begins with a descent downstairs from my fifth floor apartment, which is at the top of the building. A structure seems to be a neglected subject at SCI-Arc. Five stories is a crucial governing number, like Planck's constant or pi. In a city that privileges human locomotion as its principal means of movement, five stories becomes a kind of natural limit, gravitation's own human skyline. Stairs are also urban architecture's first invocation of the orders of social life. First step in the passage of private to public, the extension of the street by other means, high tide of the public realm. These first slides are a little dim, but things will become clearer as I go on. I descend past the plastic bags of garbage left by my neighbors for the porter. I know them by this evanescent archaeology. Jeff, secret sharer, disordered and unsociable with his aggressive heaps of unbound newspapers and ripping sacks of God knows what. Margot, whose clean landing repeatedly confirms her residence elsewhere, and whose empty, rent-controlled apartment tips my blood pressure over the red line at the systems of inequality and unfairness that New York's distorted... Yeah. Can you hear me? Distorted market-based mode of housing production yields. I work hard. Why should I pay six times the rent for an identical apartment in the same building? Thoughts of the landlord, that parasite, instrument of this unfairness, repository of my most primitive fantasies of economic determinism. He doesn't clean the hall because his grasping ethics are pure. I can't see the page. Product of the system, a vulgar Marxist's most enduring fantasy of capital. I rehearse the lecture about the idea of the civic I've been planning to give him, but we'll have to save it until I'm a little more timely with the rent. We're in a historic district, I want to tell him, though. And our building plays a role in this beautiful community of built memories. Don't you have any feeling for this? He'll reply, of course, that the Landmarks Commission prevents him from fixing up. Gotcha, I think. I know the commissioner. I'll see that the drawings are approved. Ah, but there's no money, he'll plead. All those tenants on rent control. Why don't you help them get me out, he suggests in a lowered tone, tempting my solidarity, arousing my rage. The bastard. On the front landing, I meet Jane, frail and beautiful. Please stop moving the microphone.
Good.
On the front landing, I meet Jane, frail and beautiful, asthmatic and looking very old today. Jane is the landlord's opposite, the moral center of the building and the captain of the block. She's sorting through the recycling bin, taking seriously this pusillanimous retrofit of sustainability into a city dedicated to waste. Beyond her, at curbside, stretches the black plastic Jura and blizzarding paper of New York's impossible trash disposal system. Jane is our Sisyphus, making sure the old newspapers are properly bound, the bottles clean. The culture, however, isn't producing enough Janes, enough activists of the everyday. Jane and others like her are the thin line preventing the collapse of a very complex ecology. But must a city depend on a million kindnesses a day simply to function mechanically? From her vantage point on a folding chair atop the front stoop, Jane keeps tabs on the comings and goings of the block, sensitive both to the social and the physical environment. Jane knows everybody's secrets, recognizes people, children, dogs. Jane spots criminals, can recite the history of virtually every apartment between McDougal Street and Sheridan Square. She's famous for once having jumped out of her asthmatic chair to tackle a mugger in mid-block as he attempted to make his getaway. She knows the secrets of flowers and trees. Jane tends the petunias in the concrete urn chained to the railing out front, waters the street trees, trowels the soil around them for aeration. On weekends, she works in the community garden around the corner. Great cities offer abundant choices. It isn't overstretching to suggest that this is exactly one of the links between the urban body and the body politic, that democracy thrives especially in an environment which is rich in possibilities. One measure of the physical success of urban design lies in the literal variety of means and routes of circulation, the way in which choice, body, pleasure, and convenience join to form the circulatory nets of urban movement. Mere complexity, though, is an insufficient test. Confusion is not enough, but the possibility of getting lost is one of the vital practices of urban enjoyment. My own choices on leaving my building are initially two, but eventually dozens. Let's assume a left turn. This brings us to Washington Square, the main park in the neighborhood. Pepsi, please. Dog run, drug market, performance space, beach, lung, university quadrangle, edge condition, monument. Today, I choose to follow a kind of green line to work. It isn't altogether easy. Downtown Manhattan is staggeringly ill-equipped with green areas, and retrofitting it, greening it, is a great challenge. Nevertheless, a longest stroll under greenery is possible for at least a portion of the walk. A diagonal cut across the park brings us into the sphere of influence of New York University. Two almost universally reviled buildings from the 60s by an architect called S.J. Kessler, faculty and staff housing, frame a green space of civic dimension. Although the kind of modernist urban practice these buildings represent is justly repudiated as a general model, this project and this setting are actually fine with me. Radiating the canonical modernist virtues, light, air, greenery, fairly free ground plane, a bit of a dance of roof structures, these buildings and the three later towers by I.M. Pei in the next block offer a humane and decent vision of urbanity. I don't remember the blocks obliterated for these structures, or know anyone displaced for their construction, so I simply deal with their presentness. I like these buildings, and although I wouldn't want to live in a neighborhood comprised of them, I'm happy to live in a neighborhood which includes them. Looking south through this mini radiant city, the view is down Wooster Street, one of the best, most intact streets in Soho. The vista is terminated by one of the buildings of the phone company, a great work of New York Art Deco. It's a fabulous view, and it's one that embodies a condition that's more general, of a city which accretes its layers horizontally, a kind of lateral archaeology that's far more germane to current questions than much of the present academic preoccupation with a kind of palimpsest that never existed. This great building, which I also see to the east from my studio window, our gloomy morning and sunset glowing chart, is also a great comfort for its liberations of metaphor, its frank and grand evocations of the city of canyons and mesas, a geologic sculpting of mass. We find in the studio, as you'll see later, such metaphors to be very useful, although they do, of course, have their limits. A few blocks further in this walk brings us to a somewhat more contemporary inscription. We're in Soho now, the omega of gentrification, New York's most Euro neighborhood. What could be more appropriate than this hole-in-the-wall European currency exchange? There's something almost quaint about it, the perfect image of the way in which global capital vamps locality by offering the palpability of money, those miserable, soiled, depreciating greenbacks, in lieu of the usual electronic transaction that's converted instantaneously into francs or Deutschmarks. We know it's picturesque here because tourists need to change money to participate in the kind of cash economy we would expect in an historic district like Soho. In fact, the necessity for such transactions is severely limited, required only at street vendors and at the few surviving businesses of the fading ethnic population that preceded the artists and the yuppies, and which appear increasingly alien amidst the glitz, but which ironically embody the small-scale sense of old Europe, which the new establishment strive with such desperate calculation to recreate. In fact, Eurocard or Amex is actually a lot more convenient at Agnes B or the Odeon. No finer example of this multinational relayer of Europeanness can be found in the corner of West Broadway and Grand Street, the celebrated Eurotrash triangle, which has recently agglomerated half a dozen French restaurants and cafes. On the downside, it certainly is another sign of globalized yuppie culture. On the other hand, though, it's fantastic. The tenacious embrace of the street despite excessive traffic, despite the almost complete abdication of the public realm in providing such minimal urban amenities as street trees and furniture, or even a well-maintained roadway and sidewalk, marks a circumstance which is at once hopeful and completely desperate. Arriving at Canal Street, the border between Soho and Tribeca, another truth becomes clear about the city. There are no partial solutions to the problem of traffic. Clogged and toxic virtually round the clock, Canal Street, used as an artery by cross Manhattan traffic, is a perpetual disaster area. Crossing it as I do twice a day, I'm constantly trying to invent strategies of amelioration. Such fantasies, of course, have a long history. One of Robert Moses' last great initiatives was an attempt to build an expressway across, and of course, destroying in the, coincidentally, Soho, in order to link the bridge and tunnel on opposite sides of the island, which are currently joined by Canal Street. Breathing the diesel fumes and dodging for my life, like reveries often come to my mind. Such thinking, of course, is the root of the problem. The only solution to the difficulty of Canal Street is the elimination of the traffic. The fix is not technical. The disgorging tunnel must simply be closed. Alas, there is no politician or citizenry in the world with the nerve for this particular face-off. Once we've made it to the other side of Canal Street, we're on the home stretch. 2 summers ago, this little parking lot was swarming with carpenters who were busily erecting 2 historic buildings. The smaller of them was a little house which appeared to be of early 19th century vintage. Next door, across the party wall, was a loft building of cast iron and brick, seemingly about 75 years more recent. On the ground floor was a little, desperately authentic-looking luncheonette. The entire ensemble, which you see there, took about 2 weeks to construct. Who, of course, but Hollywood could have been responsible? For weeks, the neighborhood had been papered with announcements describing the upcoming production, apologizing for any potential inconvenience, and generally trying to engage the community with the thrill of having a film set in its midst. And it was actually kind of thrilling. The swarms of scenographers distressing plywood into rhapsodic verisimilitude. The evening the rainmaking gantries arrived and inundated Franklin Street. The morning we saw Bridget Fonda drinking cappuccino in Bubby's Cafe with Harvey Keitel. A flyer disseminated by the production company explained just why they were doing it. The main setting for the film was to be the luncheonette, scene of an encounter between a policeman and a waitress that set the whole narrative into motion. According to the flyer, location scouts had scoured all of New York looking for just the right luncheonette in which all of this might take place. After looking at, as the claim went, thousands of locations, they were unable to come up with a single one that satisfied their requirements for authenticity. And so arose the decision to make the simulacrum, a fiction more real than any of the available realities. Now, the simulation is one of the central questions for architecture in cities, and an index both of our power and our loss of it in cities. As you can see, or as you have seen, the ersatz construction is remarkably persuasive, a kind of hyper-reality. I missed that film set, and not just because it was a goof. Its volumes were apt to its corner, its fake patina was rich, and in a neighborhood of expensive, increasingly expensive restaurants, Robert De Niro owns 3 within 2 blocks of here, a real luncheonette would have been great. Even I find myself becoming nostalgic for something that never was. If you look closely at this picture, you can see the film set in the background and the actual historic building, which served as the model for the ersatz historic building, in the foreground. Now, to my lights, the gap between these two constructions measures the experience of postmodern urbanity with incredible precision. I scarcely need to tell you out here that we are awash in this dreck and that no city is immune. The Disneyfication of material culture proceeds at a breathtaking pace. We are rapidly creating cities which simply lie to us, cities which have forgotten how to tell the truth, which are delinquent in the connectedness of their meanings to the real experiences of their citizens. The authentic city, by which I mean a city that is both accessible and malleable, is becoming a mendacity, a city where meaning is simply slipped in, like a Gap ad at the bus shelter, where time is just painted onto the yielding surface of space, the city become virtual beyond our or anyone's grasp. Walter Hudson is this particular nightmare made flesh. At the time of his death, on Christmas Eve 1991, Walter Hudson weighed 1,125 pounds, down from the 1,400 that had established his Guinness-certified record as the world's fattest human. He was so large that when he died, a wall of his house had to be demolished to permit the removal of his body by a forklift. Towed behind a hearse to the cemetery, his piano case coffin was buried in a double plot. Walter Hudson is for me the paradigmatic citizen of the simulated city of post-electronic paranoia, a city in which we are all increasingly citizens. What makes him exemplary, though, is not exactly his bulk. It's his immobility. Except for a tragically brief period of slimming, Hudson never left his house, unable for years to so much as rise from his specially constructed bed. He was sustained in this stasis by a kind of high-tech personal existence minimum of computer and television, toilet and refrigerator. With a Big Mac in one hand and the TV remote control in the other, Hudson led his contracted life. Hudson's size, however, is central to his status as post-electronic proletarian. His huge heft was, after all, both the medium of his immobility, his homebound invisibility, and ironically, the reason for his celebrity, for his public visibility. Like our cities, Hudson is clearly a kind of transitional figure, evoking both old and new strategies of visuality, of ways of being, and of being seen in space. On the one hand, his Baroque corpulence, his achievement, speaks of historic routines of spatiality. Hudson's distinction was, after all, precisely to have occupied more space than anyone in history. But if this kind of excess celebrates an antique volumetric spatiality, Walter Hudson's celebrity is entirely post-spatial, pure mediation, framed, if barely, in televisual space. There is something deeply poignant, even bracing, I think, in this spectacle. Hudson's unsettling intermediacy was not simply nostalgia, but a kind of resistance. In spite of culture's continuous incitements to take up less space, Hudson took up more and more, and thereby cited the real risk. In a disembodying system, being huge becomes almost revolutionary. Indeed, if the virtual city offers a threat, it is not simply to the hoary historicity of 4,000 years of city building. Such virtuality puts the character of our own subjectivity at risk by its radical resituation of the body. If the city becomes completely neuralized, if both the ritual and accidental pleasures of literal propinquity are obliterated, hard-won notions of democracy are cast into doubt. Any mediation, whether by apparatus, by regulation, or merely by extent, holds the possibility of compromising free association. One of the more ironic and striking features of this fundamentally paranoid condition is that the most nominally enfranchised members of this electronic public are those willing to submit to the most draconian forms of surveillance. To participate fully in the electronic city requires a remarkable surrender of privacy. To have virtually all of one's activities recorded, correlated, and made available to an enormous invisible government of shadowy credit agencies, back office computer banks, market research establishments, private security companies, advertisers, database gatherers, and an endlessness of media connections. Whip out your Amex card and we know where you are. Turn on your home security system and we know you've left. Order a special meal and we know there's a non-smoking Muslim in seat 3K. The ultimate consequence of all of this is that the body no longer simply exists in public space, but actually becomes public space. In the virtual city, Walter Hudson is the Piazza Navona. Electronic space is a great collapser of difference, producing a kind of maelstrom of bits, the Cartesian space of TV, an infinite and recombinant juxtaposition engine. In this system, no two images are incompatible. Mass graves in Bosnia brought to you by Beastie Feast gourmet cat food. Nothing wrong with juxtaposing things, of course. It's just that this system is only interested in numbers. The urban model this produces is, of course, the theme park, television made concrete. Walt Disney, our last true visionary of physical space, was a kind of surrealistic Tito, combining cartoon nationality into viable, creative, geographical aggregation. And sometimes it's hard to know whether to resist the fun. Watching as we have over the last 3 years as the former Yugoslavia degenerated into a kind of dark Disneyland of dumb difference, sensitive souls must surely be drawn to the sweet repressions of the consumer drug. Anything to distract these barbarians from their blood, to chill them out with an immobilizing, numbing sameness that would at least keep them seated in front of their sets. This condition reflects, I think, a crisis both for the city and for democracy. As we move to the inevitability of a pluralist world in which patterns of mobility and simultaneity become ever freer, and a new condition of mutability must characterize urban life, the monadic modernist model, the formula of the endless grid, which signifies simply the democratic right of all citizens to surrender everything which distinguishes them, to melt together in the pot of sameness of the universal subject, new models of democratic relations, models of deep complexity and fresh tractability must emerge. Electronic space has the power either to aid this process or to frustrate it. We are, I believe, potentially the last generation that will enjoy real non-virtual subjectivity, the kinds of familiar body measures that enable the city as we've known it historically. I, for one, am unwilling to cash in the power and pleasure of such spaces until it's clear that the alternative is more fun, more safe, and more stimulating, or at least that it will simply be a supplement, an enlargement of possibilities. The net, after all, also has the power to bring people together, to thwart structures of control, to make unimagined connections. Cities are also juxtaposition engines, instruments for both producing and adjudicating adjacencies. The character of our cities emerges from the characteristic ways in which they solve the problems of keeping things together or apart, whether socially or formally. Racial or class segregation, use zoning that locates work far from living, height restrictions and solar access guarantees, mandated materiality, the siting of highways, a preference for gardens, all of these taken together yield the particularity of cities. If I describe to you limestone apartment blocks filled with rich people facing a park with row houses at right angles on the blocks behind, you'll probably guess that I'm talking about Fifth Avenue in New York. If I describe green-roofed mosques, sloping hillside, labyrinthine medina, do you guess that I am telling you about Fez? I think, as I've tried to suggest, this is not simply a moment of great terror, it's also a point of incredible promise for urban design. As old constraints on adjacency are loosed, as time and space are graspable in new ways, as any place can truly be any place, our position as designers is actually liberated. If juxtaposition can really be free, then we are also free to reimagine the basic structures of urbanism according to tests which respond to our best attempts at reason, democracy, sustainability, and pleasure. I do believe that we are at a moment in history where we find ourselves in a position to reconsider cities fundamentally. This is a project I like Michael having said he was just going to read the facts. F-A-X. Now I'm going to give you the facts. This is a sketch for a project called Neurasia, a fantasy of a city somewhere in Asia, probably on a line drawn between Hong Kong and Hanoi. It's a speculation about what the form of a city of free location might really be like. Like a lot of the work we do in the studio, it's a proposition about a city that would be extremely mixed in use, a city in which a kind of benign style of production would free locationality to migrate all over the city, freed from the strictures of separation by class or by use. In this city, as with other experiments we've taken, the neighborhood is at the center. And this particular project riffs an idea of a village structure aggregated here into an urban project. It also incorporates a vision of intensive urban agriculture, which is something that came to mind during several trips to Asia. Equally, it's a project which privileges the idea of pedestrian circulation as the absolutely privileged form, but layers in numerous other modes of circulation in order to create a kind of dense skein of movement within the city. We lost the good slides, so I think the slide which shows a voided center, also something derived from some traditional Asian city-making styles, is missing here. This is the project we made a couple of years ago, which was shown at MoCA. Some of you may have seen it in the Urban Revision show, for Weed, Arizona. It's a project that was inspired by attending the victory march for the war against Iraq in New York City. I was very impressed at this march by the good-looking, well-integrated, well-disciplined young people who had come back from the war. They marched up Broadway in Lower Manhattan, but when they reached Canal Street, as so often happens, they became confused and dispersed. What, I wondered, would happen if instead of dispersing into the city and heading for the bars, they had simply kept walking, marched right up the spine of Manhattan to Harlem and to the South Bronx, and gotten to work. The idea of conversion is something that's very much with us lately, an important project for our culture. We're a country with a long history of military planning for our urbanism, as cities from Fort Wayne to Fort Worth attest. Lately, the way in which the military has impacted the development of cities is perhaps less visible, but nevertheless manifest in places like Los Angeles and the other cities of the Gun Belt. Weed, again, was a fantasy about what a small, sustainable, post-technological, car-free city would be. Instead of describing with any great precision, this is the site plan. I guess what you can see in this are the series of radiuses which describe a 10-minute walk from the center of a series of neighborhood structures. Instead of describing it in architectural terms, though, I'd like to read you a couple of fantasies of inhabitation that I wrote in order to better come to grips with what the character of this city might actually be like. Caroline, I back up, a real site is involved along the Colorado River near Yuma, Arizona, where there's an existing military base. It's in fact an irrigation project on the opposite side of the Colorado, so the water resource was available at this location as well as this vast territorial resource which the military is occupying. Caroline stares at the piece of mahogany spinning on her lathe. The order is for 1,000 legs, and the deadline is tomorrow. Because Margalit, who has designed the tables and is making the tops, is obsessed with variation, each leg must be different. and Caroline is making the variations by hand, even though the lathe is sufficiently programmable to produce its own variation algorithms. Still, Caroline wants her impress on each piece, and Marguerite herself is adamant about the unmistakability of a Caroline curve, as she calls them. Knowing that Abbott and Ramon will be arriving in a couple of hours with their dray horse Fred and the wagon to take the legs the mile to Marguerite in Nimbus neighborhood, she puts her mask back on and redoubles her efforts. The mahogany for the legs has come from Weed's forest and has been genetically altered to grow in the climate and soil of the desert. Over the past years, the area given over to mahogany cultivation has greatly increased as demand for unendangered hardwoods has risen and as Weed's reputation as a source of fine wooden products has grown. Still, supplies are limited. Although the genetic engineers have succeeded in making the trees grow nearby, they have not succeeded in making them grow any faster. Most of the tables have already been sold, Marguerite's reputation being what it is, and their distribution will be global. Because Marguerite's workshop is relatively small, the tables will have to be rippled out. Every morning, a large C container, or a mix of smaller A's and B's, will arrive via the goods net at the workshop, ready to be loaded up with tables. The pliant, corrugated, celluloplastic box with its bright holographic encoding patch will rise slowly from subterranea, and its sides will roll back for loading. 20 or 30 tables wrapped in straw mats will be loaded in, the routing patch programmed, and the container will slip back down for the quick trip to the goods intermode. Let's see, focus. Well, close enough. With the exception of the stowaway checkers, the goods intermode is fully automated. The checkers ensure not only that the occasional cat or dog which has fallen asleep in the container is removed, but that children and bargain-seeking travelers are detected. When the system was first up and running, this problem had not been anticipated. Although computers had detected unexplained weight anomalies in certain loaded containers, this was thought to be a software glitch until a teenage boy was found almost frozen to death after a trans-Pacific flight in a container full of pottery. Tennis courts for scale. Years later, long after we moved, we met the architect who had designed the building where we'd lived during our childhood. She was quite elderly, but altogether lucid, and recalled great technical difficulties she'd had working out the complex solar access requirements on a site that was, even then, hemmed in by neighboring structures. And she told us about searching for just the right greenish stone to respond to the marble Montessori school across the street. We also learned that the idea of carving the names of the tenants into the walls of the vestibule had been hers, and she was, in turn, delighted to find out that, having run out of space, the roster was now continued up the front stairway. Although the north end of town is dominated by the university and the labs, it's called the Pines for the groves that surround and scent it. Because the trees were planted when the university was itself in its infancy, certain problems have arisen. The unpredictably rapid expansion of both the de-desertification lab and the alternative transport lab have produced a minor crisis of space. The suggestion of the director of the D-lab that a few pines simply be cut down was met with outrage. She was accused of having the same slash and burn mentality as the military types from the proving ground, still shooting off their mindless missiles on a much contracted corner of their former site, and quickly withdrew the suggestion. A broadsheet headed, "That's our oxygen you're talking about, Dr. Chen," proved particularly telling. An even more powerful protest arose when the university subsequently sought to encroach on the south end of the Pines, an area dominated by students. The solution proved straightforward. The expansion of the labs was housed in one of the big loft buildings of the rectangular Vector, a 20-minute walk, 5 minutes on the slow-mo. This was especially welcomed by the developers of that portion of the RV, the rectangular vector, as the big area buildings were selling rather sluggishly. There was some grumbling by administrative types about this apparent denial of the imperatives of continuous institutional expansion, but the solution was completely convenient. Indeed, the D-Lab annex quickly developed a certain cachet because of its immediate proximity to the front nine of the municipal golf course. And of course, it was as adjacent to the world as any place else. Back to Earth. Fantasy is certainly one point of departure for talking about the city. Another of the places I think that we must begin the reconsideration is within the profession, and particularly the profession of what has come to be called urban design. Urban design remains largely a rump discipline, insecure about its reasons for being. Founded as it was in a vacated crack, I see it's 9 o'clock. Did we start on time or very much later? How late? I know you talked forever. All right, so. Move it. Let's jump a bit, shall we? Huh? Keep going? All right. Just leave if you grow fatigued. Yeah, no. I am of course an honors graduate of the Buckminster Fuller Fidel Castro School of Elocution. yeah, let's talk about urban design. Screw it. Founded in a kind of vacated crack between architecture and planning, the initiating aim of academic urban design and the profession of urban design was to rescue the idea of a physical urbanism from the humongous onus of planning, so-called. Not an unreasonable aim. The yoking of the brutal therapies of urban renewal with the enervated stylings of modernism, the double culmination of that long march of a universalism that had long since lost its way, had by the 1960s given planners a permanently bad name. Like the craven lie of Vietnam, the decimation wrecked on neighborhoods for their own good exposed a contradiction that could not but collapse the structures that produced it. Ironically, this critique came simultaneously from opposing directions. This is for you, Margie. This is the 60s section of the talk. Progressives, including locally based advocacy planners, of which I once was one, attacked the juggernaut of command urbanism, exposed its anti-democratic, even racist assumptions, and sought to empower communities. The preservationism of the 60s and 70s was galvanized as an oppositional practice in defense of homes and neighborhoods threatened by highways, urban renewal, and development. It insisted on a link between life and place, defending the complex ecologies of neighborhoods against the one-dimensional models of the planners. But while this fight for community control was being waged at a political level, a second critique was launched by efflorescent postmodernism, which constructed modernist architecture in general as continuous with the ravaging practices associated with the style. Now, while as I've suggested, the critique contained more than a kernel of truth, the reduction of urban architecture to a kind of set of stylistic peccadilloes and anemic conventions compacts no more intrinsically democratic or, for that matter, urban than those of modernism, merely resituated the discussion to another formal territory. Unfortunately, as the only vigorous and new argument available about the city, this neoconservative historicist view swept the field, becoming the default paradigm for academic and professional urban design. Now, part of the legacy of the oppositional origins of citizen participation and neighborhood preservation is a generalized fear of any physical models of the city. Decades of well-rehearsed critiques of the master plan have resulted in a kind of baby with the bathwaterism, in a reticence of vision. While many fine and beautiful designs for the refitting of existing neighborhoods based on empowerment, sustainability, post-automotive transport, or post-daddy, mom, and me domestic arrangements have been put forward, few projects for new communities that exceed received models have been formulated. Mired in a rhetoric of repair and redemption, whether from the nostalgism of the new urbanists or the softer reparations of the Greens, we are too invested in a kind of rhetoric of urban recovery, of cities of sufferers or sinners, of 12 steps back to zero. Urban design, as I think you may detect I'm suggesting, desperately needs to recover from this failure of nerve. This means that the hegemony of preservationism must be superseded. Fixated on the historical city as a form, urban design too seldom looks beyond the historical city as a site. The point is not that we shouldn't cherish and nurture our cities, but that we already know how, at least physically. Clearly, the continuing project of the historic city demands that we recognize the vitality of forms and communities at climax, or tending that way, and midwife them along, to mix metaphors a little wantonly. But again, I insist, from the designer's point of view, this is easy, at least conceptually, however difficult it may prove to be artistically, even more fiendish it may prove to be at the level of implementation. Seeing the city as it exists as both the locus and the boilerplate of its research, urban design risks blinkering itself to two of its greatest challenges. First, within the context of monstrous disinvestment and widespread abandonment, the task of reviving so-called inner city neighborhoods is enormously challenging. Again, though we are too much stuck with the paradigm of saving these places by, in effect, completing them as they were originally intended. This is misguided. Why fill out tenement neighborhoods conceived from the first as second class, places unsustainable economically, socially, and environmentally? I think it's time to start thinking of abandonment, not so much as a blight, but as a kind of resource, to do the imaginative work that will allow a better model to emerge from what should logically now be discredited. These frayed and neglected places are sites that can be relayered to become the intricate and autonomous neighborhoods of the future. We have to see these places not so much as broken, but as evolving. Urbanism's greatest challenge, though, is to come to grips with the metastases of sprawl, with the explosive growth of the territory beyond the city line. Subject to imaginative critique that never rises above that, the edge city remains an imaginative wasteland, uncomprehended by designers who give themselves over to monofunctional neo-suburbanism or to the rarefications of pure nostalgia. The edge city is the product of a conspiracy between a purely speculative view of the landscape, the dislocating side of modern technologies of connectivity and adjacency, and a design profession which remains fundamentally fearful of urbanity. To me, the answer is clear. Rather than endlessly devouring territory, let us unashamedly build new cities. What will they be like? Aha. As I've suggested, the neighborhood must be at the center. If the city is to resist the homogenizations of global culture and to reinforce the rights of its citizens to participate and give the body its proper place in space, then the delineability of the neighborhood must be assured. The neighborhood is the essential means by which the social city is comprehended. To this end, we should work to create neighborhoods that situate both the conveniences and necessities of daily life within easy walking distance of places of residence, that maximize economic, social, cultural, and ecological sufficiency, that assert an autonomy of physical character, and that share equitably with the larger metropolis. Extent, the coalescence of scale, density, dimension, and activity will be the key issue for urbanity in the next century. While neighborhoods should be scaled to walk time, It's important to remember that neither the dimensions nor the character of a neighborhood can be precisely quantified. In the pluralistic metropolis, the neighborhood is the bulwark of both privacy and of place. It is the logical increment of community. It is also the most self-evidently sensible unit of environmental accounting. Now, enduring fantasy in our studio arose when we were working on the design of a small town in Hungary. How, we imagined, would the form of a city be altered if one of its building regulations stipulated that every resident might step from a door in her building into a greenway and be able to walk unimpeded by traffic to Paris? And why not? The city exists both as an exception and a complement to its territory, legible only in relation to the green spaces in which it sits and which sit in it. The culture of exception isolates the city, rather than seeing it as fundamentally continuous with the rest of the planet. Right of access and use to green space is fundamental. Urban design must assure that this right is readily and conveniently satisfied, that a wide variety of green uses is universally available, and that both private and public access to green space is possible for everybody. Such deployments of green within the city should affect not simply the location of construction, but its form. Consider, for example, the architecture that might be, phase one, the architecture that might be induced if the equivalent of, say, 50% or 70% or even 100% of the surface area of a city were to be green. We are too caught up in an artificial dichotomy. The house and garden is only the most tentative and preliminary expression of an urban architecture with nature. There is likewise simply no substitute for the physical spaces of public assembly. Increasingly imperiled by commercialization, electronification, criminality, and neglect, both the idea and the forms of gathering are a central subject for the imagination of urban design. Public space, after all, is the lever by which urban design works on the city. A fixation on the media of production of these spaces has overcome any passion for their quality, even as a Nielsen rating mentality stupidly celebrates any gathering, however induced. Urban design must build barricades against such skewing and disproportion, must keep Giants Stadium from annihilating Washington Square, even as it seeks all the alternatives in between. The internet is great, but it ain't the village green. Free association and the chance encounter only take place in a space of freedom, which is secured by the meeting of bodies in space. Embodiment is the condition of accident, and accident is a crucial measure of democracy. Unembodied rights simply do not exist. This, I believe, is the principle Walter Hudson died for. This is a project for a competition, I think. Got the flu. Oh, this is turning into a two Pepsi lecture. I'm going to pick up the pace. A project for the Spreebogen competition in Germany. Being Germany, of course, we were very preoccupied with the character of democracy and public space. And this is a project in which our basic argument was that public spaces of a wide variety of configurations and a great variety of scales would be useful for thwarting any potential surveillance and would be useful in confusing the authorities. I've jammed a lot of architectural slides in here, remembering, of course, that this is a school of architecture, so slightly off the subject, I'm going to show you a bunch of projects. This is a second scheme. Next tray. That was the Spreebrogen competition, sank without a trace. This is the Spreeinsel competition, also sank without a trace. But another scheme in which both a kind of confusion of density plus a wide array of public spaces was used in order to engender the kind of possibility for accident that seemed crucial to us in the center of the city. Equally, this is a meant to be a point from which a greening of the city might radiate. Another, a similar kind of proposition, which I stuck in as a kind of chromatic transition, since we're using the same prismacolors. This is a scheme for the center of Atlanta, which was and may still be, although probably not anymore, an existing, not very viable, but definitely a real neighborhood of poor people. Just behind Peachtree Street, which I believe the Olympic authorities in their wisdom are decimating in order to erect Coca-Cola stands and other Olympic ephemera. We propose to them that rather than doing this, they insist that this neighborhood in formation be reinforced as a neighborhood, and that the density, the low-rise density of the neighborhood be reinforced by the addition of other structures, and that the existing community be supported rather than displaced. If I were continuing with the formal portion of the lecture, I would talk to you a bit about traffic. I think I don't need to come to Los Angeles to offer people instruction in traffic, but I do have the solution. as you know, in most of our cities, the major proportion of the municipally maintained public realm is the infrastructure of streets and traffic support. In old cities like New York, where this is fitted to the body of a city that could never have anticipated it, the car is simply an inadequate means of urban transport. And in cities like New York, the situation is somewhat different here, we argue that the city must yield its absolute priority to the pedestrian. I think this also requires a great deal of nerve to resist the enervated arguments about flow and about the inevitability of traffic and move to certain dramatic means of reduction. As I say, I think in historic, traditionally designed cities, the formula is actually rather simple. If in New York one wanted to reduce automobile traffic by 25%, one would simply reduce the space available to it by 25%. Eliminate one lane on every street and replace it with greenery, leisure space, recycling facilities, walkways, and other desperately needed infrastructure. Likewise, a 50% reduction in traffic might be achieved by an immediate 50% reduction in the space available to traffic, and so on. Of course, we also need to think in a visionary way about new systems of movement in cities. Bikes are great, rollerblades are great, but they're not enough. And this is part of our responsibility as architecture. We need to think of new technologies. I don't think that we can repeat the mistake, which is historic, of constantly trying to retrofit cities with movement technologies that don't love them, with railway cuttings or with freeways or whatever. I think we have as our duty, as urban designers and architects, to reject the kind of mentality of available choices that seems to shape all our thinking about transportation, and embrace the idea that we can formulate a series of rational bases for fresh desires. After all, if we can't even describe anymore the characteristics of a superb urban transport system, I mean, what would it be? Invisible, silent, small, leisurely, mobile in all three axes, friendly. It's only because we haven't yet taken the trouble to truly imagine it. The architectural interlude. I will show you some projects quickly and then I really will conclude. This is a project that we've been working on in an ongoing way for East New York, which is a place in Brooklyn, almost to the edge of New York City, it's out towards Kennedy Airport. It is one of these typical tenement neighborhoods out at the edge of the city, which is suffering badly from all the consequences of abandonment, both physical and social. And we've been speculating in the same way that we've been speculating about how the resource of this abandoned military territory might be used as a kind of leverage for a fresh urban vision, how this abandoned territory in the city might likewise be used as a way of infusing a kind of fresh character of the city for the intervention of green, for the establishment of new patterns of living, for the integration of workplaces and places of residence and places of recreation, somehow to defeat the monofunctional mentality that created this place in the first instances. We've had three iterations on the project, and I seem to be confused about the order of the slides. This is the second, and speculates the way in which a kind of wiggly green vector might arrive in New York, in East New York, and begin to set up an alternative system of movement that flows through the spaces of abandonment, rather than trying endlessly to resuscitate streets that will never have the appropriate order of vitality. A third order of the speculation was an inquiry into what the minimum intervention might be in order to begin to leverage the kind of change that we would be pursuing in a neighborhood like East New York. And we decided that the minimum intervention might be simply to plant a tree in the middle of an intersection. The assumption was that this would have two consequences. The first, I betray the anxiety of the middle-aged male with this metaphor. When your coronary arteries become blocked, it sometimes happens that a system of collateral circulation is formed in the heart, that the blood finds a way of flowing through numerous small detours around the point of blockage. So our imagination was that the planting of these trees in the midst, you can see this slide, yeah? I don't have to search for the laser pointer. The planting of these trees in the middle of the intersections would lead to the formulation of collateral circulation patterns, which would in turn begin to create a system of green space, a green neighborhood within the gridded pattern of the existing neighborhood. A second effect that we would anticipate from the planting of this tree in the middle of the intersection is that the frayed life of the traditional street grid would find itself consolidated at a series of intersections in red, and that this kind of traditional street-based urban life would densify to the point where it actually was both viable and vital. Here's the first phase of the project, and I'll show you a bit more of this in a minute. This is the project called Shrooms, which is also located in East New York. And here the idea was the invention of a sort of architecture of lofts, which again I believe is absolutely central to reimagining the way in which use will be mixed in the city, that would flow through these abandoned spaces, which largely exists in the middle of blocks. So this project is located on four blocks of East New York, and actually is located in the space of abandonment, and aims, as I say, to create this new axis of movement, which is pedestrian and green and alternative to the life of the street, but without actually dislocating any kind of existing residents, giving them something in addition, a supplement rather than a replacement. These are the plans for the project. Again, a kind of riff on the idea of a new kind of public space. So we imagine in this project that what public space really is, or should be considered as, is a kind of resource out of which a multitude of private fantasies must be drawn. So there is a kind of traditional idea of public space embodied here, which is the greenway which flows through at grade. Also a traditional idea of semi-public space in the middle. Maybe I will point to something. In the middle of the project is what we've been calling the green room, which is a semi-public space available to all of the residents. And then as you proceed outward in each of the structures, the space becomes increasingly private. These series of pods or pads or shrooms or whatever they are spaces with no specified use, which await private fantasies of inhabitation. This is the ground floor, a middle floor in which you can see the further complication of the pod system. And finally, I guess this is still a middle floor. I've got the wrong slide. It's the problem with these glasses. No, this is a roof plan. Finally, when you get to the roof of this structure, the character of the public space reverts again to a completely public kind of a system. A little bit of a Jetsons rendition. On to the next. A project, this is the project that inspired the shrooms. Again, a competition some of you might have done for the souks of Beirut. And in this project, we imagined a big, part of the competition brief was for a kind of fruit and vegetable, a produce market. So in our scheme, this produce market was housed under these mushroom-like structures, which again, are used to propagate a kind of vector or system of movement which flows through the interior of the project. And we would hope, you may know in Beirut, the line that divided the warring factions was called the Green Line. So one of the things this project proposes is that a new kind of green line be introduced into the city, which would be a line that didn't separate but united. So here it flows through the project. The series of shrooms, there's an upper level, a plan of the market. And in this section, you can see one of these shrooms. And on the tops of these shrooms were to be located a series of gardens. Again, this idea of the linked roof gardens that would serve as the outdoor spaces for these residential blocks that were on either side of the project. There you can see them and the massive underground car bombing space. Quickly, the famous condominium project in Florida. Again, I don't know what slides I've got here. Let's go back to the plan. A notion about taking a project, I mean, as any of you know who've done a project of this sort, the principal difficulty in site planning, of course, is dealing with cars. Which, if arranged bumper to bumper on the site, would completely cover it. In this scheme, the main notion was that the cars would not do that, that the center of the project, indeed the periphery, would be reclaimed for the use of people on foot, both from the project and from the neighborhood, and that these structures housed a series of ramps which got the cars up to an upper level, the parking up here, but the ground plane allowed to remain free. There's a model of it. Occasionally, we go a little bit off the... these mutations get the better of us. A fantasy about a building in Tokyo called Godzilla somehow embodying all post-nuclear anxieties. But at base, also a serious proposition, again, like that German project I show you, in which this project is meant as a way of establishing a kind of beachhead for the greenification and pedestrianization of the city. From each of its tentacles would spread, again, a kind of mixed biometaphor, tendrils of greenery that would somehow take over existing streets and creep into the rest of the city, greening it. A project on which we're currently working in Vienna. This is a somewhat conceptually misbegotten project which might be characterized as one small site, seven big egos. It's after the manner of the Fukuoka project, in which a number of architects were invited to as they charitably put it, collaborate. here we are. Here's Eric. There's a strong Californian flavor. Here's Eric Moss's site, and here's Mark Mack's site. We keep revising our project because that's what we thought you were supposed to do in these exquisite corpse enterprises. This is the second of our projects, a series of little creatures, each of which is divided bilaterally so that every apartment, which was the kind of instigation of the project, has both an orientation to this direction, which is the most favorable solar orientation, but also a series of more intimate relations with neighboring buildings, more kind of traditional urban neighborly relations. That was a kind of a vision of that. Also, these trees are always on the damn roof. There's that project. Decided there are too many creatures, and we're currently in the process of revising it into fewer, wigglier creatures. And we've done a revised site plan. So in this one, this is, here's Eric, here's Mark, here's Raymond Abraham, and here's Coop Himmelblau, and Tom and Charlie have been displaced to this block by the municipal authorities. And here are our three new wigglier creatures with fewer elevators. Their plan. Another of their plans. A sketch. And a lovely model shot. Yeah, another lovely. They're solid gold, of course. The municipality will pay. What's begun to happen to the city as locationality really begins to float, as I've suggested, is a kind of saturation of the mix. All the hyphenates and bifurcates, the new mutants of an exponentially splicing culture, demand repeal of monofunction. Urban design must finesse this new mix by exploring the urban tectonics not simply of new uses, but of unknown transformations, creating a city that is both malleable as a loft, but with all the fixity of a work of art. One of the principal territories of this investigation will necessarily be the compatibility of sizes. Were production to cease to foul the environment, and were classes, races, and nationalisms to desist in denying each other's enjoyment, enforcing segregation, anything might now appear anywhere. That this as yet cannot truly be, as I've suggested earlier, is at the core of the crisis of our culture and creates a series of problems concerning the appropriateness of juxtapositions, questions that go to the heart of both our politics and our art. As I finish up, I show you some slides of a project for the waterfront in Brooklyn, New York. This is the Brooklyn Bridge, for those of you who know it. This was a counterproposal to a Olmsted-like park project that the municipal authorities are thinking. And we simply tried to imagine a project that would be both amphibian and would propose an extreme density of uses on what would invariably be an extremely highly trafficked site. Architecture is urban by convention, recording the accumulated compacts of city citizens. Climax is the key. Cities are form-making engines, and the job of urban design is to astutely recognize indigenous forms that have reached some kind of perfection. Good point, huh? Beautiful logics, once established, are entitled to architectural citizenship, a certain inalienability of rights, which reflects the rights of the established neighborhoods and social ecologies which inhabit them. Climax, a term borrowed from foresters and sexologists, is a condition of homeostasis, a permanent stage of growth. Urban designers need to nurture the reciprocating forms of architectural, social, economic, and environmental sustainabilities in cities, whether Fifth Avenue, Fez, the marble-stepped row houses of Baltimore, the deco density of Miami Beach, the variegated textures of neighborhoods in Brooklyn, the piazzi of Milan, or the bungalows of Hollywood. Future climaxes, the forms of cities yet to be built, will participate in fresh fantasies, finding their forms in the sustainable tectonics of a bioregional view combined with the visions of their citizens and artists. Form, after all, does enjoy a certain autonomy, originating in use and circumstance, but eventually free of it. Reinforcing such character is a great task for urban design. Reproducing or simulating it is not. For urban designers, finally, there can be no other goal than to make city life beautiful. We are negligent in our tasks if we fail to engage the technologies of desire, the means by which we enlarge the city of sense, the millionfold techniques of an urban erotics. Urban design should swell with optimism, with myriad prospects for metropolitan happiness. Although sites of eternal conflict, our cities must, in the last analysis, be the product of deep, deep love. Happy Valentine's Day. Yes, I'm happy to answer questions. I'm told to repeat questions. the speaker praised my work extravagantly, and he asked me to draw a comparison between some qualities in my work and some of Rem's work, which you'll all go see tomorrow, I presume. It was also a question about surrealist strategies in urbanism. I believe in the kind of surrealist engine as a kind of means of invention. I can't really speak about Rem's proposition for bigness since I'm not so conversant with the theoretical texts. But I think I do argue in my work, both the kind of drawn work, the spoken work, and the written work, that although the juxtaposition engine of kind of exquisite corpse tactics is something extremely useful as a goad to creativity, as a way of engendering a series of juxtapositions, it's inadequate without an additional operation, which is an operation of adjudication. I do have a kind of ludic fantasy of urbanism. I like the idea that there's a kind of initial phase of play, and the exquisite corpse, you know this game, does describe to me very well a kind of an initial phase of research or investigation. The other game to consider that metaphor, though, that I think has to be introduced following the kind of production of the exquisite corpse is the scissors, stone, paper game, which is a game about hierarchies, which is a game about value. I don't make an argument that there is a surrealist urbanism which derives its authority from a kind of direct connection to the unconscious. I don't believe in unconscious urbanism. I believe in deliberative urbanism. I believe that the city is the result of a set of compacts. And that each of these compacts is something that can be investigated closely, both for its social origins, for its origins in governance, for its origins in theories of democracy and in ways of being together. So although I participate in a kind of artistic relationship to certain surrealist activities and certain surrealist images, I certainly would not propose that the test of viability or authenticity in an urban work can in any way be celebrated either by its weirdness or by its claim to somehow expose some authentic operation of the unconscious. Okay? Thanks. Gotta get this thing. Oh, my clock. Hey.